Friends, welcome to the next lesson. This is on administration during British period. Now we deal with features of the British rule. It has an importance. The main characteristics of the British rule are discussed briefly. These relate to the creation of the Indian Civil Service, the secretariat system, pay, promotions and transfers, financial administration, financial accountability, administration of justice, local self-government, and bureaucratic leadership. Indian Civil Service. The most important legacy of the British rule in India was the creation of the Indian Civil Service. It represented the visible presence of the British in India, and it was through its expanded network that authority was wielded. The members of the ICS constituted the essence of British power in India, and without them, one would not be able to speak of a British empire in India. As described earlier, the twofold division of the covenanted and uncovenanted services was retained by the Aitchison Commission of 1886 and 87, and in 1892, the two services were christened as the Indian Civil Service and the Provincial Civil Service. Another important contribution of the British rule was the idea that the competitive examinations be conducted by an independent agency. Accordingly, the Federal Public Service Commission was created in 1926 and entrusted with the task of recruiting civil servants. Another substantial contribution of the British was institutionalizing a training system. Efforts which began in 1880 with the setting up of the Fort William College at Calcutta continued with several modifications and innovations till the end of the British rule in India. The idea was to train the personnel not only in the service of the empire but in the service of the people as well. Details regarding the contents of the training system will be dealt with later on. Here, it is suffice to say that training in Indian languages and law was stressed substantially. Languages were given importance in order to bring the official a little closer to the common man or common people. Local laws were emphasized since their knowledge helped to make the civil servants more competent. Staffing the secretariat. The idea of a central pool drawing manpower are evidence of the practical genius of the British. Before 1920, each individual department recruited its own staff independently. In 1920, on the basis of the Government of India, made upper division clerks of the secretariat part of an imperial secretariat service and appointed a central staff selection board to supervise the recruitment process. The staffing pattern of the central secretariat underwent change as a result of the suggestions made by the Tottenham Committee of 1945 and 46. Later, in 1950, the old Imperial Secretariat Service was replaced by the Central Secretariat Service. Some features of the secretariat system were quite discernible: heavy reliance on presidents, incapacity of the lower grades of official to share responsibility, and the practice of excessive record keeping and noting. The legacy continues even today. Pay, promotions and transfers. A well-developed pay structure for civil servants was also devised by the British. In 1918, the posts were divided into superior and inferior categories. The system of promotion also brought about an onslaught on the tradition-bound Indian society. In India, a person born into a low caste had to remain low and die as such. The element of promotion on well-planned lines developed by the British provided an element of social mobility. Spangenberg points out a defect in the transfer policy and the government. The frequency of transfers sapped the vitality of the British administration. It acted to the detriment of district administration, particularly because it nullified the advantage of Oriental loyalty. It was not uncommon to find 3 to 4 sub-divisional officers changing in a year. Financial administration. During the company's rule, revenue was obtained from 2 sources: land revenue and taxes on trade and personal property. The expenditure was classified into heads: security or defense and social and development services. The latter comprised of education, public health, etc. By far, the most important administrative innovation was the introduction of the budget system, while the financial resolution of 7th April 1860. Under this system, the financial estimates for each year were to be arranged, considered and sanctioned by the Government of India before the year commenced. It contained the anticipated income and proposed expenditure of the empire. Under the same resolution, a central revenue department was created in Calcutta to integrate and coordinate the activities of all the revenue authorities. At the same time, an imperial audit department was also set up to examine whether the departments were adhering to the provisions of the budget. Yet another important contribution of the British was the introduction of government paper currency in 1860. The Bank of Bengal became the agent for the printing, issuing and circulation of the notes. Paper notes from rupees 1 to rupees 1000 was issued. Financial accountability. A full-fledged and systematic mechanism of control was also evolved in 1919 when the C and AG was made responsible to the central legislature. In 1926, he was given the power to inspect any government office of account. In 1922, a central public accounts committee was created, consisting of both elected and official members within the financial members as the ex officio chairman. It considered the Auditor General's reports on the reappropriation amounts. Thus, through these two bodies, the Indian legislature was to exercise control over the administration of public finance. The creation of a standing finance committee with the finance members as its chairman was another practical step in the field of control. It had the duties of a public estimates committee. Moreover, the public accounts committees were created in each governor's province. Under the Act of the Central Legislature of 1934, the Government of India established the Reserve Bank, which began to function with effect from 1st April 1935. The foundation of the contemporary police administration in India was laid during the British period, particularly after the enactment of the Indian Police Act 1861, which created an organized system of constabulary. It is noteworthy that the Indian Penal Code IPC of 1860 and the Code of Criminal Procedure of 1861, along with other significant legislations such as the Indian Evidence Act, constituted the legal framework of criminal justice administration and held the police system to exercise its functions effectively. These legal instruments have become important components of the legacy of the British rule in India. Administration of justice. The administrative spirit of the British rule was evident in the field of judicial administration as well. However, in the earlier stages of the company's rule, when its covenanted servants had very little idea of the laws of the country, they retained the old practices. Consistent with this principle, Hastings combined in the office of the collector both revenue and judicial functions, keeping in mind that the Amal Guzar under the Mughals had the power of collecting revenue and of trying certain cases too. A drastic change based on the concept that the judiciary should be separated from the executive was introduced by Lord Cornwallis. Hence, the Cornwallis Code of 1793 took away the judicial power of the collector. He thus laid the foundation of an independent judiciary. The code provided for three-tier system of European judges with the Jilla and City courts at the bottom, the Provincial Court of Appeal in the middle, and the Sadar Diwani and Nizamat Adalat at the top. The creation of an intermediate tier of provincial courts was intended to lessen the workload of the Governor General until Bentinck's time. Indians were not interested with any posts in the judicial setup, but Bentinck's successor, Holt Mackenzie, recommended that the primary jurisdiction in all cases except a few be vested in Indians. He also removed the intermediate tier as it slowed down the process and flow of justice. He enlarged the jurisdiction of the district court to make justice locally available. Local self-government. The British, while retaining some aspects of the ancient village system, introduced some changes in local administration. The Government of India Resolution 1864 had admitted that the people of this country are perfectly capable of administering their own local affairs. Hence, statutory recognition was granted to panchayats as petty courts in Bombay and Madras. In 1870, Mayo's government also included the panchayats in the management of funds devoted to education, public works, etc. Another important reform was made during the time of Lord Ripon, who has been called the father of local self-government in India. In 1882, he introduced a new policy through a new act. The resolution dated 18th May 1882 recommended the extension of the elective elements in rural bodies, reduction in the size of the official element, and elected non-official as the chairman of rural bodies, and financial decentralization. The Decentralization Commission of 1990 examined the problem of local government in great detail. It suggested a three-tier system, village panchayat, the local tehsil or sub-district boards, and the district board. The Montague Chelmsford Report of 1918 on Indian constitutional reforms examined the existing system of local government in the country and came to the conclusion that local bodies should be vested with greater powers and outside control be made minimal. Through the Act of 1919, local self-government became a provincial and transferred subject under a responsible Indian minister. Laws were passed in every province for the growth of village panchayats. They aimed at increasing the strength of elected members to the extent of making them the immediate arbitrators of policy in local affairs. The Act of 1935 introduced provincial autonomy, but due to the Second World War, up till independence, nothing more could be achieved in this realm. The secretariat system. Until 1843, the central secretariat was situated in Calcutta and was exclusively under the control of Bengal civilians. It consisted of a secretary general, three assistants, and clerical staff. There were three departments set up: military, foreign, home, and financial. Military affairs were managed by the military department, all foreign and diplomatic relations by the foreign department, matters of justice, education, and legislation by the home department. And the financial department, though created 3 months earlier than the act, looked after the financial operation, the provision of ways and means, etc. in 1855. A separate department of public works was created. The portfolio system was introduced in 1858. The essence of this innovation was that a member of the council would be appointed in charge of one or more departments of the government, and he would issue orders on behalf of the Governor General in Council. In 1871, matters relating to revenue and agriculture were taken away from the Home Department and put under a separate Department of Revenue, Agriculture and Commerce. This underwent several changes and mergers. In 1805, during Lord Curzon's time, the control of the railway system was entrusted to the Railway Board. On 1st March 1905, October 1905, it was designated as the Railway Department. In August 1921, medical administration was transferred from the Home to the Education Department, which was renamed as the Department of Education and Health. In the same year, a Department of Industries was created. Due to the pressure of work brought about by the Second World War, the Foreign and Political Department was split in 1937 into two separate departments, that is, the External Affairs Department and Political Department. In 1941, three new departments were created, namely, information and broadcasting, civil defense, and the Indian Overseas. The last department was renamed the Commonwealth Relations Department in 1944. Bureaucratic leadership. That the personalities of individual administrators through a subordinate factor in history exercise a high degree of influence in the formulation of policies and decision making is something that no historian or student can fail to recognize. Prominent among these who left a mark of their constructive genius on the development of modern administrative system in India were civilians such as Thomas Monroe, R.M. Byrd, James Thomson, Sir George Campbell, Sir Andrew Fraser, Sir Harcourt Butler, and Sir Malcolm Hayley. As a class, they represented imperialism. They were all top civilians who guided the course of administrative changes in India. They were leaders of bureaucracy who were intimately associated with policy formulation and decision making. Although the McCullough report had laid emphasis on civil servants possessing qualities like industry, self-denial, and perseverance, the Royal Commission on Decentralization 1907-1909 was unhappy regarding the conduct of junior ICS officers. It pointed out that barriers continued to exist between the government and the public. In the words of Syed Ali Imam, the executive counselor sympathy loses so largely as it descends down to district officials that hardly any trace of it remains visible. The commission insisted that the young officials be specially instructed in matters of Indian etiquette and be carefully trained on that regard under selected collectors. Secretariat reforms. The British consciousness towards reforms is depicted in the setting up of several commissions and committees. The Secretariat Procedures Committee recommended in 1919 a pyramidal organization for every department with a secretary of the top and at least two deputy secretaries. It recommended the abolition of the post of under-secretaries except in the finance department. The idea behind these changes was to reduce administrative delays and expedite official business. It is obvious that the contemporary Indian administrative system has been built on its British heritage. All India services, civil service recruitment, administrative training, the secretariat system of office procedures, management of districts, revenue administration, police system, budgeting, accounting, auditing, and a number of other structural and functional areas of Indian administration have their roots in the British rule. Though the British had their own objectives of sustaining and strengthening their empire, to which the administrative system was geared, some of the consequences of their organizational initiatives have proved to be useful to India even after independence. There was a large part of India which was only partially or just marginally affected by the British rule and its administrative initiatives. More than 550 princely states of the country did not experience the same kind of administrative innovation which the British India did, despite the progressive policies of some of the princely rulers. The chasm in the structure and working of the administrative system of these two Indias was significant. there is a clear need to examine the sources of such divergence and diversity. Question number one, discuss the British administration in India. Question two, what are the main features of British administration? Question number three, the regime of Lord Cornwallis constituted a landmark in the history of the civil service in India. Elucidate. Question number four, the contemporary Indian administrative system has its rule in the British rule in India. Comment.